When my son or daughter hurt themselves or experience pain, they cry. That's normal. It's one of our body's natural responses to pain and sadness. And when they cry, my gut intuition is to wrap my arms around them in a big hug, pat them on the back, and encourage them, you know, quietly whisper words like, "Oh, don't cry, sweetheart. Don't cry." My gut intuition to say those words is wrong. So if I say those words, I'm subtly teaching my kids that expression of emotion isn't okay. I'm telling them they shouldn't cry. I'm telling them that whatever hurt them isn't a big deal and they shouldn't be feeling what they feel. I'm not helping them learn how to experience and process their emotions. It's a pretty normal response, though. We live in a culture that just isn't comfortable with deep expression of emotion. We want people to contain themselves, you know, to keep their feelings inside. In many churches, the situation is even worse. Some churches, like we've talked about, they just ignore emotions entirely. They aren't a subject of discussion. Other churches, they only see emotions as a negative thing, you know, a temptation or a distraction, something that you have to manage so that you can follow God well. But neither of these models allow us to grow fully into the image of Christ. Why? Because your emotions are not a flaw. They're not a weakness. They're not sinful. Emotions are not a failure of God's perfect design. Emotions are an integral part of how we were created. Genesis 1 says humanity was created in God's image, and our emotions are a part of that. As uncomfortable as emotion can be at times, they have an important role in our life. Emotions help us prioritize. They're one of the building blocks of intuition. And most importantly, emotions are designed to move us. That's what they do. They help us go beyond data and reflection, and they propel us to take action. Now, we know this intuitively. I mean, why is it that parents and pastors tell their kids not to make emotional decisions? Or why is it that we tell young people when they're dating, don't make a decision in the backseat of your car about how far to go? Why do we tell them that? Because we are afraid of the power of emotion to move us. But see, that's what emotions were designed to do. That's the gift they give us. Emotions move us. Now, it's true. Immature or broken or unprocessed emotion can move us to act in inappropriate or dangerous ways. But healthy, mature emotion does exactly the opposite. Those emotions move us in a godly direction. They help us do the right thing. They help us act with courage. They help us stick up for people. They help us serve and act in love. I mean, think about all the crazy things, the good crazy, that followers of Jesus do. People who pack up their families and move to a tiny village in rural China where they don't even speak the language on the hope that they might make a difference for people there. Now think of people who make a choice to radically change their lifestyle, to be more like Jesus. People who adopt just one more child even though they don't really have the finances, or people who invite a homeless person into their life, or people who practice shocking generosity, or people who have offered transcendent forgiveness when they've been victimized or violated. In the church, we'll often celebrate these people as models of godly obedience. But when you get inside their story, when you hear them explain why they did what they did, they don't usually tell you that they did the right thing because it was the right thing. They don't usually say that they made that choice because of an intellectual understanding of who Jesus was and a philosophical commitment to his teachings and lifestyle and values. When it comes down to it, people do difficult and courageous things because they are moved. And that's the purpose of emotion, to move us, to propel us forward in life, even to move us toward maturity in Christ. Now, this can happen, but it won't happen if we don't take the time to learn how to listen to our emotions. It won't happen if we don't practice what we learn. Unresolved pain and emotional immaturity can keep us stuck on the dead-end streets of denial and minimization and rationalization and disconnection. And in those places, we're left at the whim of emotional responses that we don't even understand. Even worse, we will not hear the critical information our emotions are bringing us, and we'll be left to navigate life without the aid of an important God-given compass. Discovering how to read that compass is why I wrote The Wisdom of Your Heart, Discovering the God-Given Purpose and Power of Your Emotions. If you would like to see that compass more clearly in your life, then head over to www.thewisdomofyourheart.com.